Welcome to Music School for Tomorrow, a three-day virtual symposium developed by the Alliance for the Transformation of Music and Academe, ATMA, or ATMA, in collaboration with the College Music Society. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this presentation of CMS webinars. As we begin this third session of the symposium, I would welcome all attendees and panelists to reflect upon the lands on which we live and work. All of us, in fact, sit on lands that are historically tied to tribal nations. We acknowledge the harm that this country, a settler colonialist nation, caused by systemically and forcibly removing Indigenous people from their lands. As professional organizations striving to shape our musical worlds as decisively anti-racist, ATMA and CMS acknowledge the harms of slavery, white supremacy, and systemic racism tied to the institutions where we conduct our work. We acknowledge that acknowledgement is not in and of itself enough. Indigenous people still live here. Black and brown people live here. We pay our respects to those and other people of color who, in the face of great harm, continue to make contributions to our institutions and our profession as we strive to lead change that results in more equitable futures while engaging with our exquisite, resilient histories. Before I turn the screen over to our colleagues with ATMA, I want to alert you, the attendees, to three items of logistics. First, all of our sessions of this symposium will be recorded, edited, and posted for public viewing in the CMS library on the College Music Society's website. Second, please know that attendance at each of the symposium sessions requires separate registration via the College Music Society's event pages. I'll put the link to the registration site in the chat in case anyone here needs to register for later sessions. And finally, each day of the symposium will feature an open discussion session at 5 p.m. Eastern time. And I will post the Zoom link to the discussion session in the chat as well. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Ed Sarath, founder of the Alliance for the Transformation of Musical Academe. Dr. Sarath serves as professor of jazz and contemporary improvisation at the University of Michigan, and among many other achievements, is the author of Black Music Matters, Jazz and the Transformation of Music Studies, published in 2018 by Roman and Littlefield. Ed, thanks for your great work, and now welcome to this third session.
Thank you, Bill. We had got off to a great start yesterday, and now we're in day two. And this is just, this has been an amazing ride, and I can't thank the College Music Society enough. You know, it's a longstanding, venerable organization, a real pillar in the field. A lot of visionary, a track record of some very great progressive thinking. And ATMA is just a new kid on the block, just been in existence for a few years now, so this is a real honor. I'd also like to thank the student team, Samuel Dunlap from the University of Michigan, Georgia Hears from Oberlin Conservatory, and Paula Wilson from Indiana, for basically, they've masterminded the event and they've been working on it for months. And they also need a big shout out because they're graduating seniors preparing, they've all played the recitals and planning this major symposium with all that going on. I mean, that's that bodes well. And, you know, the thought of, we hear this, the emergence of the artist activist, and we have three leaders in that, on that trajectory right in our midst. So bravo to all of you. And I'm going to turn it over as Sam. So Sam, you're moderating this session, right? Or is it Paula?
I'm moderating today.
Okay, so I'm going to turn it over to Samuel Dunlap, who's graduating with a Jazz and Contemplative Studies degree at the University of Michigan. And he's the moment he walked in the door at Michigan, he already had his sights on changing the world, and he's doing it.
Thank you, Professor. Thanks everyone for coming. Thanks to the panelists and the people registered. It's incredible. We already have almost 60 people, so great. I wanted to start just by talking about some general agreements for the conversation today. The first one is just kind of mostly for the panelists, to help you remember, it's called WAIT, W-A-I-T, why am I talking? in the conversation today, we're coming as thinkers and as improvisers and, learning how, being aware of how we can, you know, contribute in the most meaningful ways is really important. The second one, the second agreement is confidentiality. So if somebody shares something kind of personal, maybe we can take the lessons from that and leave the details in the meeting here. The third one is for everyone to being open to learning, normalizing the changing opinions when new information here is presented and talked about. This is a conversation that's emergent and hopefully going to catalyze a lot of new thinking and a lot of new change in schools around the country. And then the last thing is to be open to someone else on the panel kind of speaking your truth, and know that you don't need to just keep repeating something somebody else has said. And we want a diversity of opinions, and we want to get into the nuances of the conversation. And so Paula is going to put those in the chat here, if she hasn't already. With that, I would like to move on to introducing the panelists for today. So maybe we could start with Garrett McQueen, and then after you just briefly introduce yourself, maybe pass it on to somebody else.
Sure, thank you very much. My name is Garrett McQueen. I'm calling in today from the land of the Sioux, specifically the Wapakuti of the Eastern Dakota. I exercise that practice not only as a land acknowledgement, but as a statement of protest toward anyone who continues to misappropriate this land, where I am anyway, as a place called St. Paul, Minnesota. My ultimate goal is for when my grandma sends me a birthday card, for her to write the correct land on the envelope, and not the city of St. Paul, Minnesota. So as we all continue to move forward in our land acknowledgements, I hope that we'll think of it not as an exercise, but as a mission with a very specific goal. As for me, I'm a classically trained bassoonist. I spent 10 years as an orchestral musician. Around 2016, I began to transition into the world of digital and broadcast media. And today I work independently as a content creator with nationally syndicated programming, including The Sound of 13, Gateways Radio, The Sounds of Kwanzaa, and an upcoming Juneteenth special called Remembering America. On the digital front, I write for several websites, including National Sawdust. I lecture at countless colleges and universities, and I'm the executive producer and co-host of the Triloquy podcast. It's a pleasure to be here with you all today, and I'll pass things on to Ms. Latanya Hall.
Hi, everybody. Pleasure to be here today. My name is Latanya Hall. I'm an associate professor of jazz voice at Oberlin Conservatory. In addition to being an educator for 15 years, I've spent the last 35 years as a working musician. I have a couple of records out as a solo artist, reimagining great jazz standards. But I've also have my feet firmly in the pop world. I've spent 35 years on the road with a variety of different artists as a support artist, artist all the way from Diana Ross to Rob Thomas, 17 years with Bobby McFerrin and Voicestra, and the last 10 years I've been with Steely Dan. I also have been blessed to have a great career as somebody who's works a lot in the studio. So I've done everything from commercial jingles to voiceover work to probably over 110 record dates for a variety of different artists, and really love and treasure that side of the business as well. And I look forward to talking with you all about your place in this business and how to navigate it all. I'm going to pass it on to Miles.
Okay, well, thank you. It's an honor to be here with you all. My name's Miles Okazaki. I'm calling in from Brooklyn, and I've been a lecturer at University of Michigan since 2013, so about 8 years now. I teach guitar. I play guitar primarily. I'm a touring recording musician, and I have this educational component that has been increasingly more important to me as I move on through my career. And I've been trying over the years to find some ways to develop curriculums that really are building things from the ground up that don't rely so much on where you're coming from in terms of your background and all that, things that just have to do with hearing and sound and improvisation and the things that were more in line with the way that that I learned and a lot of people learn when they're learning like jazz and other kinds of music that are taught orally. And that's where I'm coming from. And I will pass it on to Tanya.
Thanks, Miles. My name is Tanya Smith. I'm here today on the land of the Wampanoag people in south of the city that we refer to as Boston. I teach at Boston University. I'm assistant professor of music education, and I've been a music educator in various components all of my career. I'm most interested now in project-based learning, student-driven learning, and expanding the teaching force to include people who come from all musical traditions. So I will now pass off to Anthony.
Thank you so much, Tanya. My name is Anthony Branker. I'm calling in from Somerset, New Jersey, close to New Brunswick. I've been involved in the field of education for 36 years, 3 years in secondary school and 33 years in higher ed. Currently, I'm on the jazz studies faculty at Mason Gross School of the Arts at Rutgers University. Teach graduate courses in jazz historiography in composition and arranging, and supervise student teachers who are actually out in the field doing their student teaching placements. Prior to that, I was a member of the faculty at Princeton University for 27 years and was director and founder of the program in jazz studies there. I've really been fortunate because I've had a lot of different kinds of school experiences. Princeton obviously is a liberal arts institution, also taught in the conservatory situations at Manhattan School of Music and the Estonian Academy of Music in Tallinn. Smaller liberal arts schools like Ursinus College, a city university like Hunter College and the CUNY system. And that really has informed just, I think, so much about my outlook and the kind of spaces of learning that I would like to create for my students. I'm a composer. I have 8 recordings out, mostly on Origin Records, and all of those recordings contain my original work as a composer and have had a chance to feature some fantastic artists like Fabian Almazan and Linda Mahan Oh and Rudy Royston, Ralph Bowen, so on and so forth. I'm a conductor and have worked on projects with Terrence Blanchard on campus with Slide Hampton, Jimmy Heath, Phil Woods, Oliver Lake, just a wide variety of artists. So one of the things I try to bring to the classroom is developing with the students an awareness of other ways of knowing. I think that sort of is central to how everything else is organized. So that's sort of my story and I'm sticking to it. and I want to introduce Jeff Scott.
Thank you. It's a tough one to follow. I'm Jeff Scott. I am the Associate Professor of French Horn here at Oberlin College. My career's been varied and fruitful, I have to say, both in commercial music and in classical music. I've toured with artists such as Luther Vandross, Barbra Streisand. I've recorded with jazz artists like Chick Corea, Wayne Shorter, just incredible artists. The thrust of my career has been 25 years with an ensemble named Imani Winds, and also teaching at Montclair State University in New York City and the New School for 18 years until I was blessed with the current job that I have now for just under a year here at Oberlin College. And let's see, to go here to find out.
That's everyone for today.
Is that everyone?
Oh, yeah. That's cool. Thank you everyone for introducing yourselves. And Yeah, I'm really glad that we could bring you all here. You know, just hearing side by side, you know, all of you talk about kind of what you've been doing the past several years makes me really excited for this panel. You know, we're trying to think about, 21st century musicians, and it seems like you all are really leading the charge and have forged these really unique paths. So maybe I can just kind of start the conversation by kind of talking a little bit how I got into thinking about this. And I remember my freshman year at Michigan, I took the majority of my kind of core music classes, two music theory classes, two musicology classes, a piano proficiency class, and then I had my more department-specific jazz classes like private lessons and jazz ensemble and that kind of thing. I remember getting frustrated because I was stuck in these core classes trying to learn the conventions of the field, which often had really little to do with developing my own creative relationship with music or musical skills that I could apply in my ensembles and study on my instrument. And this is something that we kind of touched on in our panel yesterday. I'm just not experiencing this. There was a bunch of other students that talked about it. And before that, you know, it isn't just my generation. Professor Ted McDaniel said that when he was in school, it was kind of the same thing. So to kind of start the conversation, I'm curious specifically about kind of these, the skills specific, the musical skills that you developed over the past few years. And are these showing up in our core classes? And how are those skills things that you came to on your own? And did they happen inside the music school or outside the music school? And what did that look like? You know, a lot of students are probably tuning in here and maybe you want to get a sense for like, okay, maybe I am a senior and I'm just graduating. How do I kind of define my path in the world of music? And what does that look like to kind of navigate that in a self-directed way?
I'll start this part of the conversation, but before I get started, you know, I just want to make sure that I name, you know, over 20 years ago when I was handed a bassoon for the first time and I had no idea what this thing was, and neither did my parents. I went home and got in front of my computer and typed bassoon, and the first two pieces of music that I discovered, performances that I will never forget, is a performance of Vivaldi's E minor bassoon concerto and an arrangement of Piazzolla's Libertango as performed by Imani Wins. If I didn't see Monica playing the bassoon, if I didn't see at that point five Black musicians playing this, I may not be sitting here today. So I mentioned that as a start because that is really the only time in my early development when Blackness overlapped with my experience with music. As I, you know, as I went through my career and won auditions and had a tenured orchestra position, I kept thinking back to those early days and realized that there was very, very little Blackness that I was experiencing. And when I say that, I'm talking about the music that we performed, my colleagues. I was more often than not the only Black person in the building, much less the only Black person on stage. And I wasn't seeing a real engagement of Black communities. So that was the impetus for my shift into digital and broadcast media. Now, obviously, as a classically trained bassoonist, I didn't have the skills that I needed to produce a radio show and do those sorts of things. So the learning curve was very high. But what I attribute as the biggest tool that I learned on that journey was a better education, a deeper education of the repertoire, really being embedded in radio libraries, going through all of those LPs and different CDs. I was hearing the names of composers and performers that I had never learned over the course of two degrees in classical music. So for me, the biggest skill that has propelled me in my career is just revisiting the idea of what is the canon, what should be included in the canon, and realizing that it is so much bigger than our education and performance institutions teach us. Of course, there are other skills along the way when it comes to using Pro Tools, knowing how to plug in a microphone and all those sorts of things. But what's really central to my work and what I really attribute to the success I've had on the B side, I'll say, of my career, is really understanding the repertoire and understanding that there is intention behind what we're taught in school, which of course drives, you know, my activism in turning the page and really helping institutions understand that we have to completely demolish and completely rebuild our structures so that more students have an opportunity to engage music performance, and everything in between in a way that actually speaks to us and not in a way that we were taught to speak to audience through repertoire, through common performance practice. So that's what I would like to lead with here. So as we talk about those tools that we need in our careers.
I completely agree with you, Garrett. And thank you for saying that. We had a panel at Oberlin last week where we had seven faculty of color talking about their experience, and it was so beautiful to look out and see those faces and also to hear from my students on quite a frequent basis about how representation matters, right? And not just in the faces that they get to interact with, but also in the repertoire that they are taught. Another thing that I think is really missing from a lot of the core education in a lot of music schools is teaching them the business. You know, this is something that Jeff brought up last week when we were on a particular panel, but it's something that needs to start being taught from the freshman year on, because the habits that they're developing starting out in these schools are the habits that are going to keep them employed once they get out. And what I've seen is just a real dearth of knowledge. And it's something that I try to instill in my students in my particular studio. But I think it's something that needs to be taught curriculum wide. And it needs to start small in the freshman year with just the basics of what they need to learn business wise. But also too, it needs to go much deeper than just the basic business skills, but something that addresses the new paradigm of how the business operates today. Students have no concept about streaming models. They have no concept of the new digital platforms that are not only on the scene now, but that are going to come in the future. They have no concept of how to build a brand. They, you know, and these are things that they're learning from places like TikTok, right? Or stuff like that. And we need to give them something a bit more substantial than that. So I think it's important that we begin to stress that as a basic part of every music school curriculum.
I would say that my preparation really began once I graduated from my master's institution. The canon prepares you to play your instrument or to sing in a manner very particular to a certain style of music, very particular to a certain genre. And while it gives you facility on the instrument that can take you pretty far, it doesn't give you one an understanding nor an appreciation for how you as a musician can fit into other genres. And for a lot of young musicians, that ends up being the defining moment as to whether they even continue to study the craft. If they don't feel a connection from an early age to the music, if you don't feel a connection, because when you look at Bach or Beethoven or Brahms, it just doesn't call you. It doesn't, you know, a lot of classically interested young people start to lose interest because they don't see themselves represented in the canon. And so I believe that the canon needs to be expanded. I don't think it needs to be completely thrown out. I think there just needs to be room for more styles of music, different ways to train. The same seminar that Professor Hall was talking about this week, that panel that we were on, I stressed that I believe that the doors and the bridges that separate our classical division here at Oberlin and our jazz division needs not only to be bridged together, open, but there should be a core curriculum that includes the two. Some of that training, I believe, really needs to start even earlier on. I think if, you know, if this country began to embrace the fact that we have our own music, that's our very own, and it has value, I think that, you know, higher education institutions would then, you know, follow the lead. But it does need to start early. And we could do our part, I think, in higher education institutions in, you know, bridging that gap somewhat. I just know that I am not the musician I am now if I had not been introduced to some very learned, patient musicians who brought me along to the other side and introduced me to a language and a style of playing and musicians that looked like me and told me it was all right that I studied Bach and Beethoven. In fact, it's fantastic, you know, but here's this other way of playing, this other music. And it shouldn't have to be, you know, after you've graduated that you are finally introduced to this.
To piggyback off of what Jeff was just speaking about sort of this, and this was brought up yesterday in discussions on the core curriculum and, you know, this notion of what must be taken out in order to include something else, which can be and often a non-starter, a way to blow up the conversation to begin with. I remember Dean Gary from Rutgers mentioning, you know, it's not about the binary opposition. It's more about a way of finding, which Jeff talked about, expanding the offerings, expanding the nature of the core curriculum to be more inclusive, which I think is absolutely doable. I mean, obviously there's, you know, heavy lifting that's involved, but I think that's a major part of it. I will say this, so I think we all understand and can testify to the fact that, you know, when we begin our journey as educators, we often teach as we were taught, right? There are messages and lessons that have been passed on to us through our own involvement as students, and they resonate, and we, you know, utilize them in some way for good or for bad. And for me, I followed that, you know, that path probably for my first 16 years of involvement in teaching in, or 19 years maybe. And then later in my career, I went back to graduate school. And it was a promise that I sort of made to my dad. You know, very early on, I was accepted in 86 to a doctoral program at Rutgers in composition. And at the same time, I got my first college teaching job, right? And everybody says, well, whenever you get that, don't turn it down. Wherever it is, go for it, because you can kind of build upon that. And so I did. My dad, you know, was getting ready to pass, and this conversation sort of reemerged, and it was something they really wanted me to do. So in the mid-2000s, that's the direction I went. And I'm so happy that I did that. I went to the Teachers College at Columbia. I was in an environment with thinkers that were examining the interaction between educator and student, looking at the space of learning, or looking at so many things through a different lens and perspective than I had been. And it just opened up a whole world of thought to me and a whole consideration of what I wanted the space of learning that I was promoting or trying to create to look like. And so, you know, one of the things that I mentioned before is that I really wanted this to be a place where students develop an awareness of other ways of knowing. And that's a very broad statement, right? And that's a very inclusive statement. Maybe we could balance it off against what the core curriculum often reflects in many institutions, right? It reflects a certain model or paradigm that's based on a Western European thought and of what the world looks like, of what music looks like and its place in culture. But what about those other voices, right? What about the inclusion of those other voices, wherever they may happen to be, whatever they may happen to be? So voice is a very expansive term. For students involved in music making today, we have to recognize that those things that are influencing their lives, the things that they're exposed to, are very different from what we have gone through in our own education. They see the world in very different ways. Technology has a major place. The world is a smaller place for them, you know, whereas we may have had to go to the library and pull out some LPs or reel-to-reel tapes. Now I'm really dating myself when I say reel-to-reel tapes, and listen to, you know, musics of disparate styles. They hit a button on the computer, they Google something, they can check out what's happening in Eastern European folk music or the music of, you know, wherever. It's immediate. And these influences find their way into what these students want to create, what they want to sound like, what they gravitate towards as listeners. And we have to include that. We can't be, as educators in whatever realm, and pardon me for saying this, we can't be pompous and feel like, you know, well, what we know is is the most important thing. This is the body of knowledge, right, that's been passed on to us, and we're going to pass it on to you because we want you to look like us when you're out on the job market. We want you to be a reflection of what we went through. It's a different paradigm now. And I think we have to understand that, and we have to embrace that. And as educators, we have to be willing to still want to learn, right? We can't just kind of stop and say we're fully formed. We want to be able to embrace what our students bring to us, be open to their experiences, be open to the music that they introduce us to, or anything they introduce us to. That has impacted me in profound ways. And I can't thank these students enough, and it continues to happen. And I think it's important. It's an important part of the equation. It's a little thing, but it's a big thing, you know? I think it's something that's easy to enact and embrace if we're willing and if we're open to that. So anyway, thanks.
Yeah, that's really interesting. One thing that I'm kind of hearing, you know, as you just said, Anthony, and as Jeff was touching on a little bit, you know, it's not about, you know, these kind of binaries of we have to learn classical music or we have to learn Black music, or there's a certain, you know, particular right curriculum. And that secondly, that there needs to be more space for students to express and also discover with their teachers about what it is that they want to learn and grow with. And I've, on a more personal note, I've been studying with Professor Okazaki for 2 years now, and I've taken his classes, and he teaches a fundamentals of rhythm class at the University of Michigan. And that's a class that really isn't really defined by a certain kind of cultural boundary or parameter. And so I wanted to invite him to talk a little bit about that class and what kind of the organizing principles around that class are, how that might kind of be just one of the many examples that is kind of like emerging in the 21st century of kind of a new music studies.
Well, I'd like to jump off of what Anthony was saying about multiple ways or many ways of knowing. This is something that I've always identified with since the earliest days of studying music. My first teacher was not actually a guitar player, but he did play guitar, but he was trained as an ethnomusicologist. And so he kind of knew like the hip stuff from wherever, and he actually worked in the music, in the record store, and I'd go down there and I'd get like, okay, I got this Wes Montgomery record. He'd be like, well, if you're into that, you know, you might want to check out Sun Ra or something. He'd just go all the way in a different direction. He's kind of like the original, like Amazon algorithm. You might also like, but it's sort of actually the opposite, because it would be like, well, you're getting a little bit used to this. I think you should go, if you're interested in rhythmic music, maybe you should check out Muñequitos de Matanzas or something. Like, it's just something I never even imagined existed. And of course, as we said, in those days, you don't just click the button, you wait a couple of weeks for the record to come from wherever, and you're waiting, and it's a big deal. And so that way of listening and that way of really, you know, doing deep dives into one or two records is sort of the way that a lot of us came up. And I like to try to find ways of not only replicating that feeling of discovery and curiosity, but also the sort of skepticism that I grew up with is like, well, it's not just this way. It could be this way, you know, and Western harmony went this way. It could have gone another way. We didn't have to go with the 12 tones. It could have been 19. It could have been a lot of things, you know. It's not like that all over the place. Listen to this music from India and this music from Iraq. And now, having been in the field for a while now, a couple of decades of doing music, and for whatever reason, my sort of main thing that I get called for is to do just really far out projects with a lot of different kinds of people. I seem to be adaptable, and it might be that sort of training that I came from, which is just sort of like, it's all music, we're all humans, we can find a way to make it happen, you know. And so, you know, if I'm doing a project with some drummers from Mali and we're able to do something, like, what is going on there exactly? Like, how is that possible? They don't read music. I don't know their tradition. We're just trying to find this area, you know, of sound that we can communicate in. And so I'm very interested in trying to see, you know, with various degrees of success over the years, but how I can kind of develop some curriculum that just deals with sound, you know, and just deals with actual skills that are practical, because my main thing is kind of like, well, where the rubber meets the road, you know, like what makes you more employable? What makes you sort of useful in situations, you know? Is it sight reading? I mean, sight reading's one thing, but I play with plenty of musicians who can't sight read. And in fact, I'd rather play with musicians that have great ears than musicians that can sight read really well and don't have like a good rhythmic feel or something like that, you know? So there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of, and of course, if you deal with somebody from if I'm, you know, playing with somebody from India, like, they're not going to be able to deal with this chart that I give them. Like, they, you have to find another way, you know? And so in those, I've, you know, been collecting throughout the years, sort of my experiences in those situations and thinking about what are some universal things that we do as music makers, and what are these, some of these many ways of knowing, even within a very limited field like jazz. We go to play a standard, some people learned it from a chart, some people learned it off of a record, some people are reading it, some people doing it by ear, you know, and we're all able to do something, we're all able to improvise and make something happen. So even just in that little area, there's many ways of doing it, you know. And so in this class that Sam is talking about, it's just a course on rhythm, which is, I was always shocked, like, even when I was in, as an undergrad, I was like, where's the rhythm? Like, who's talking about rhythm? Because that's the music I was most interested in. It was always like highly rhythmic music and jazz and Black American music and music from Africa and India and stuff that's very focused on rhythm. And it's just harmony and notes and pitches. And I was like, well, okay, you know, is there a way we can have some sort of detailed way to study rhythm? Like, in a way that actually builds skills, not just like, here's a groove from Cuba and play this, but actually like what's the version of, you know, harmony, like cadences and things like that, like all those things that we talk about with our specific language, 2-5-1s and all that, what is that rhythmically, you know? Is there a way we can study in such a way that I don't need to hand you a chart, that you can just internalize that thing in the way that is useful to you to go forward and to be useful to other people and to be, you know, to be employable. So, I mean, that's always been my concern. Am I going to work or not? You know, so that's, I'm very interested in that as well. Not just sort of piling on information, but can you actually do things, you know?
Miles, I have to say, I firmly believe that every curriculum. I don't care what change, you know, ends up, you know, coming down the pike for whatever institution, but I firmly believe that every curriculum should institute learning by ear. That we embrace the idea of oral tradition, because there's very little music in the world, in the history of the world, that was written down. You know, that's a very narrow, very, very narrow tradition. And that a musician coming out of undergrad has a deficiency in performing, in that they can't perform without a piece of sheet music in front of them, is a travesty. That you can't play unless you actually are looking at a sheet of music, but we call ourselves a musician, I think is a travesty, because there's so much music that then should have been taught to you by rote. And we have it right here. We have the music, so many styles of music right here, and not just jazz and blues, so many others that are done by oral tradition. And it should be part of the curriculum.
Couldn't agree more. Also memory, you know, memory is not something yes. that we practice very much.
And yes. that's
a huge part of so many things, you know, so.
Tanya, I'm kind of curious, like, you know, just we're talking about, you know, oral skills and learning by ear. And yesterday, we talked a lot about, you know, this is, you know, a lot of people here are operating in higher ed, but, you know, this can really start at K-12. And I know that, you know, you're in music ed, and what do you see as kind of your role as like someone who's training future music educators, and you know, is kind of this kind of conversation about, you know, rhythm and learning by ear and oral skills something that you're thinking very much about? And maybe how are you thinking about addressing these things in your pedagogy?
Absolutely. I think it's central. A couple of things that I would like to riff off of about that. Garrett mentioned at the beginning how important it was to have representation. So in the field of music education, we have a largely white teaching force, largely female teaching force, which is a problem. We need to be able to recruit music educators to have a very broad skill set. And we've had a lot of trouble being able to recruit those folks into schools of music, because we have in most music schools, we're only able to accept people that have skills on classical, you know, instruments or voice. And some schools have jazz programs, so we have a little bit wider body there in those institutions. But largely, when you look at where most of the large music ed programs are, we're still very bound to that. And we're bound to people who have been trained on notation. So to be able to diversify the workforce, the teaching force, if you will, to make it representative of the diversity of students in our schools. Remember in 2042, that's the year that there'll be fewer white people than there will be persons of color in the US. Well, that's already happening in our lower grades of school. We need to radically change the demographic profile of the teaching force so that there is representation. And simultaneously, we have the opportunity to be able to bring musicians who have multiple skill sets, are bimusical, who can both read notation and be able to teach and to convey and to learn music by ear. But we don't have that right now, but we absolutely need it. That's essential, because in a lot of communities, they're not interested in band, orchestra, and chorus as a model anymore. Yeah, sure, there are definitely some communities that want that. Great, no problem. But our music teachers must be able to go into any community and be able to be well-versed and have a broad enough set of skills that they can embrace the music of that community. As Ed speaks so eloquently in his book, it's important to build a very strong scaffolding on the musical tradition that is yours, and then branch out and to develop skills beyond that. And I think that can happen in the upper grades. But we, as music teachers, need to be able to know our students, know what music they love and what their families are loving, and build upon that musical knowledge, no matter what it is, whether if that's, you know, gospel music from church or whatever it is, we need to like, oh, what do you love? And build on that spark and then expose them to lots of different traditions. So absolutely, but we have a lot of things we need to absolutely flip. And getting off book is a very important first step, I think.
I'd be remiss if I didn't offer a little bit of pushback to a couple of the things that we've heard here. So, and Miles, please correct me if I'm mischaracterizing what you said, but when we think about the notion of what Western music, what American music could have been, I think the notion of that question is inherently violent, because it erases the reality of why Western music, specifically American music, is the way it is. The traditions that have gone into our teaching institutions and into our performance institutions were intentionally manufactured based on racial norms. So I really had to make sure I mentioned that. Also, I think it's very safe. I think it's very easy for us to talk about expanding the canon, expanding what we expose to students. But from my perspective as a radio programmer, there are only 60 minutes in an hour. There's no expanding that. So there has to be a very intentional conversation of what is being taken out from my perspective. When we talk about concert series, when we talk about curriculums, when we talk about all of these things, there are parameters. And I really hate to push forward the notion that we don't need to talk about what needs to be taken away, because I think that's the part of the conversation that we don't actually have, what needs to go away.
I might jump in and just to think about a reimagining, because that's a great point that you're making, Garrett. I think that it's not even necessary for something to go away. It's more important that that same thing needs to be reimagined, right? So what takes place in a particular course that is labeled, you know, music history this year to that year, so that, and this is just, it's common sense. I mean, everyone has talked about this, letting the body of information of the whatever's presented in such a course setting to be more inclusive, right? And not just geared towards the Western European canon or ways of looking at the world. I think reimagining what happens in the classroom in other ways can be part of an expansion. So here's an example. I was thinking about, and this was a question that was shared with us to sort of think about coming into today. And I think it had to do with recognizing some of the blind spots that have existed in music education, the things that, you know, we have either not considered or chosen not to consider. And the notion of collaboration, I think it's an important one. The notion of bringing together in a setting a multiplicity of perspectives, experiences, and allowing those to interact and learn from each other. And so this, I segue from that statement to a couple course offerings I had when I was at Princeton, and I hope to be able to offer that at Rutgers at some point in time. But the title of the course was The Improvising Ensemble. It spoke to this notion of not using notation, right, which Tanya brought up before, and it had to do with reimagining the process of creative music making. It was for instrumentalists, it was for vocalists. There were 20 students in the class, and I just really lucked out the very first time it was offered, because the representation was so diverse in terms of the musical experiences. There were kids that were involved in jazz, only 3 of the 20. There were students involved in classical performance, members of the orchestra, chamber music, involved in ethnic music, students involved in classical Indian music performance. And what happened was that the students were involved in these activities that involve collaborative music making, that made use of freer approaches to music making. So oftentimes there was a different way of approaching it. One may have been using the visual to inspire the sonic, where they would view artifacts of art, whether it's oil paintings or sculpture or whatever, sculptures. I would put a slide on the screen of the classroom. I would have a small group, and this is largely a small group oriented course, dividing into three or four musicians. And I said, I want you to play the slide. I want you to play this piece of work. And initially, just to throw them into the deep end, I didn't give them any preparation. I didn't give them any parameters. I just wanted to see what would happen naturally. And the students found their various strategies and entryways into dealing with this. Obviously, it was maybe a little upsetting for them initially, but it was one of those things that as we progress and gave them the chance to work in collectives and have a conversation and come to mutual understanding, listen to each other, negotiate, have a conversation that's in a democratic space, they were able to now embrace this and then bring in their own sources of inspiration. So we use visual arts, we use movement, right? We use spoken word. Had them do sound walks where they're in nature for 30 minutes and come back and utilize whatever they may have discovered as part of the creation of a piece of music. We had guests coming in. So the part that was really important that I don't see as something that is as widespread is allowing for the students to be self-directed, allowing them to be involved in deep collaborative kinds of experiences, which allows them to take ownership, right? And when they take ownership, they're gonna approach this in a whole different kind of way. They feel like their voice matters. And this goes back to what I was saying before. We have to allow for our students to contribute to these conversations, contribute to their own education, whether it is in learning, whether it's in the creation of music. So it's an expansion, but I think within the nature of certain kinds of courses, these things can be utilized. I think Ed at University of Michigan has, I don't know if it's sophomore theory class, but it's one where there are a variety of musical languages that coexist. And it's like, okay, we can approach it this way, but we can also approach it this way as we're talking about harmony, as we're talking about melody, as we're talking about structure. And so the students are now being exposed, like right there on the spot, to other ways of knowing, right? To what exists and the possibilities, rather than their experience being channeled in one direction and believing that this is the only way that it can be. That turns off students for wanting to be part of it, for participating. And you don't have participation, you're not going to have representation. So anyway, I'll leave it at that. And that might be something that comes up in the next seminar, seminar meeting on Black Music Matters and how all this might integrate into the curriculum in a different, deeper way.
Yeah. Tanya,
I'd love to double back about a few of these things because all of you all are making such incredibly salient points. I want to talk a little bit more about what Miles and Jeff said. And again, this also touches on what you were just talking about, Anthony. I also think that we need to take a look at the admissions process and how we admit students into conservatories and taking into account that some students come from that oral tradition versus their tradition of learning from written notation. I've done a lot of adjudications for people wanting to come into universities, and I've been at live auditions for people wanting to come in. And I've heard some unbelievable players who have no Western European theoretical background, but they play their behinds off, right? And I've seen those students, I've seen them not given as much scholarship money, not looked at as credible applicants because they're unable to read or unable to do the things that other students coming in do. And I think that is an inherent bias in how we admit these students, how we see these students, because we're talking about that centeredness, right, that, that Garrett was talking about, and how we center assessment. And I think that that's something that really needs to be looked at.
I absolutely agree with that. And I think that as a music educator, we're looking for a very different skill set for music educators than for performers. And oftentimes the very best candidates for music ed are rejected based on performance criteria. And they're the ones who would be, as Anthony was just eloquently speaking about, they're the ones who'd be open to the collaboration, would be open to the project-based learning, the arts integration practice, to being there and being be with people that have radically different traditions that they're coming, and how to hold a space for those people to collaborate together in a meaningful way. And that is a special skill set that sometimes someone who is an expert and is has a virtuosic skill in just one narrow area has not developed those other skills that would allow them to do that kind of collaboration. And that absolutely needs to be centered. Who are those people that could be those the very best music educators that we need in schools today to be able to have a more, not just inclusive, but a more to allow anyone from any tradition a viable path forward as a musician, whether they want to do that professionally in their community or just for their own well-being and for their family. I think we need to also understand that most of the musicians that I educate as a music educator are not going through a professional path, but they often are the most excited about music of anyone. They're the ones that are going to show up at concerts. They're the ones that are going to continue playing just because they love it so much. We can't lose track of the love of music, no matter if that's a professional pathway or a personal pathway of enjoyment. Both of those need to be honored and respected.
This is a really great conversation. I want to come back to something that Garrett was saying and rock the boat here a little bit. There's a question from the audience. Do you feel like educational project going forward is a reformist or abolitionist one? And I guess one thing that Professor Sarath has written about is thinking about Black music as having a really rich, and he just put this in the chat a few minutes ago, but a really rich breadth of epistemological diversity in which many people in the Black musical tradition in popular music and experimental music are composers, are band leaders, are improvisers, learn orally, learn written music, learn many of the skills that are required for classical musical training and beyond. And given that, our music schools right now absolutely center classical music, to center Black music at the as kind of the prevailing 21st century paradigm for the way that we actually educate students includes classical music, right? Because it includes skills like playing in tune, right? Like the Duke Ellington band, right? And it's like there's a lot of those overlaps. And so, yeah, kind of coming back to this question, it's like, and we're going to talk about this more in this afternoon, but thinking about, are all these changes that we're making sufficient, like adding one class to the curriculum that's a diversity and equity requirement, or adding one, passing some sort of change that says that universities have to hire one Black person a year. It's like, really, don't we need to go deeper than that?
I'll be very brief in my response. So I am on the abolition side of that conversation because I think it has mired down our very language. You said that the institutions center classical music. No, the institutions center white European music because the Negro spiritual is classical, because the Javanese gamelan, the djembe, the South Indian veena, the Japanese shamisen are all classical instruments. So the institutions absolutely do not center classical music, they center whiteness. So that is why I'm on the tear it completely down and rebuild it, because if the foundation is whiteness, we'll never get to what American music and what American musical institutions should be. And I think that's apparent in the very way we ask these questions.
Hey, can I jump in here? It's I'm not on this panel, but if I could, I just couldn't contain myself.
Welcome.
This is an amazing thing. And just going back to Anthony, thank you, Anthony. So good to see you, my friend. Mentioning the musicianship class and the diversity of it, but the thing, as I emphasized in the chat, I mean, and this is coming out, Garrett is delivering big time in this. The key to diversity in the 21st century America is Black American music. It's a foundational pillar. Thank you so much, Garrett. Any talk about adding a course is like rampant in decades and even in the last year of this, you know, we need a course in Black music. Are you kidding me? It's a foundational pillar. It's got to be. And the thing is, you know, I've written a lot about multiculturalism is a huge problem and it needs to open up to transculturalism. Multiculturalism is actually conditioning music studies progressivism into more racism. In the transcultural move, Black American music is too big to put in a multicultural box. There's a transcultural term that goes deep into the spiritual creative foundations. It's a foundational pillar. And here's the thing that I'm trying to say, and I'll go into this. I'm gonna end the sentence because I got my day in the sun comes up in a second at 3:30. The reaction among even many progressives that they have trouble with the idea of centering Black music, because what are we doing? Are we centering white? Are we moving from white music at the center and Black music? The thing is, it's a category error. Centering musical Blackness is centering the most epistemologically diverse knowledge system in the history of the world's music that is going to open up more connections. It's going to deepen. And Jeff is so beautiful, like you articulate this, and Garrett too, I mean, you're both coming from that. It's gonna deepen engagement with whether it's European classical or whatever. Okay, so we have to change not just one narrative, we have to change multi-level narratives. I'm out, love you all.
Let me also quickly say, you know, going back to, you know, Imani Wins and Jeff, the work that you've done. A few weeks ago, I had the opportunity to curate a chamber music program for an institution here in the land of the Wapakuti. And I decided to include Valerie Coleman's Portraits of Josephine. Now, the horn player who had to play that tune, maybe she reached out to you. Shout out to Darcy Hamlin. You know, there were skills that she had to learn, you know, to play that piece of music. So, you know, as Ed said, when we're centering Black music and the Black experience, we're all benefiting from that. That horn player has skills that she can take to any other piece of music now based on what that Black experience and what that Black centering required. So again, if there's anything that I hope anyone remembers from what I say today, is that the very phrase classical music has been whitewashed to center the European canon and the European aesthetic. When we demand schools to center Blackness, we're demanding them to actually start centering what actually is classical music within the context to the United States. I didn't mean to leave anyone speechless, but
I think that it I'm going to say something here that might seem a little bit off, but my first music education position was in a rural community in Illinois. And I was, you know, leading the pep band, right? Because I was the band director. And I have my trumpet, I'm a hornist, but I had a trumpet in my hand because it was a small school and I didn't have enough people up in the stands to pull off the band, right? Really small school, first gig. Anyway, I had a farmer come up to me and say, "Tanya, I see you're working really hard up there. You're doing a great job. We're glad you're here, but guess what?" He says, "I don't know that the pep band is really working. wouldn't it be cool to have like a classic rock country band up there? Like that's the music that all of us here really love. And it would require like half the number of students, and maybe it might even sound better. Ouch, but he was right. And there was a part of me that was excited. It was like, oh, you know, I've always, during undergrad, I was hoping I was gonna learn some of those skills. I didn't, I was a hornist. And then all of a sudden, someone's asking me to do that thing, but I had nowhere to start. So I had to go off and learn those skills somewhere else, right? And I had to learn how to play guitar and bass, not with notation, off book. I made myself do that so that I could come back and do something different in the school that might work for that community, right? And so I shouldn't have had to do that though. If I were appropriately prepared as a music educator going out, I would be able to address whatever music was the music that was most vital to that community. So it's not just and not only, yes, it is Black music. I mean, country music is heavily influenced by Black music. We can't ignore that, right? But it's American music. All of the music that we value has a deep component and goes back to the beautiful traditions that have come and influenced one another in so many different ways. And we can unpack racist ideas with that because we can talk about the musicians who've come together in the loving space to create beautiful music together and who's influenced who and give everyone appropriate credit. So there's so much opportunity in mixing this up and taking it in a new direction.
Maybe I can jump in. I don't know if this is gonna make any sense, but Sam, you were talking about this, bringing it back to the, are you on the side of reforming or abolishing the current systems? And I mean, I guess that I don't feel like I'm really even educated enough or haven't been around academia enough to know even what that means totally to me personally. Because my focus has always been like, in terms of, now I'm talking about training musicians to play instruments. So that's a kind of a specific thing, but it's always been just, how can I make this interaction with this person as individual as possible so that there's not a big overarching thing that I'm trying to impose, you know? Because for me, it's always been, well, what is it that I learned and that I remember? It's the thing that I pursued on my own that I became interested in. So I ask, Sam, I ask you, well, what are you into? What are you into right now? Okay, let's do this. If you want to get there, maybe you want to do this and this and this, you know? And then my job becomes not as an enforcer of some sort of canon, but as a, my responsibility is to have enough breadth of knowledge that I can go in different directions, you know? And that's something that's a continual process, you know, it's a continual, because I'm constantly, you know, I mean, obviously you all know that the more that you study, the more you discover. And also, I mean, bringing it back to what Latani was saying in terms of like technology and new platforms and what's happening with business, like that is all changing. Like I have to keep on top of that as well. You know, if I'm going to be a responsible advocate for this person who's going to go out there and try to make something happen, you know. So, and Garrett, I didn't quite understand the point you about the violence of the Western music thing. The only thing I was trying to say with that was that, even within that area of white European music, that could have gone another way. You know, I was just saying, in terms of it was more a technical issue, like in terms of a tuning system. It wasn't like, you know, it wasn't in terms of the canon really. But anyway, I just wanted to bring up this idea of following the spark of each student, trying to identify, and that it's, I know it's a lot of work, you know, because you can't just redo what your course from last year and here's the syllabus and all that, but. And I have the privilege of doing mostly one-on-one teaching, so it is more like that. But even still in small lecture classes, I try to figure out, well, okay, we're not gonna grade it based on you against this person. We're gonna grade this about on you versus how you were a month ago, you know? Because when I'm teaching rhythm, I mean, people have hugely different abilities in here. You can't have it based on some sort of, you know, universal thing. Can you or not do this exercise? It has to be based on are you improving? You know, are you working on it? You know, and so I just wanted to bring a little bit of that into the conversation.
I guess I could just sort of underline the fact that I think that, you know, the introduction to many music styles, many different ways to approach music, that can be, and I think on some level has to be what happens at a very, very early age. It shouldn't be left for the higher learning education institutions to bear the brunt of starting the students from that point. We're going to have to with this generation if we're to turn it around. But I think I forget the young lady's name, who's the educator on the panel here. But you know, we were talking about starting with K-12. It very, very succinctly has to start from that early age for an appreciation and an understanding of all the different opportunities and the acceptance of so many different musics. I think personally that our job, when you get to this level, especially when you're talking about institutions like University of Michigan, Oberlin College, and you know, great institutions like that, is to have the faculty in place that encompasses the breadth of knowledge to then expand upon that, that the curriculum reflects that, and that we've already done the job of reimagining what theory is, what a contemporary ensemble should perform, what an orchestra program should entail. We need to then reimagine that and allow the palette to be as broad as possible, uncentered, of course, on white music, but a broad palette so that a student then can make their own gumbo, so that they, you know, they choose their path. Of course, there'll be core curriculum that, you know, that says, you know, there's, you should have a certain sample size of certain things so that you get introduced to it all. But it should be up to the student then at that point to decide what their path is. And I think one of the biggest problem is that there's only one path right now. And that's the biggest issue that we face, is that when we stare at our, you know, we stare at a curriculum and we also stare at our faculty, we realize that the majority of our faculty are only able to teach one style. That's what we have. And I think the hard part and the difficult part is dealing with the fact that that's got to be dealt with. And there's some people that are going to either have to change, expand, continue to learn, or not be part of the change. I think that's the difficult part.
Samuel, in the chat, you said that we'll be moving to questions soon. So if I may lead that off, you know, I'm looking at a question here from Paula. What do you say to the faculty member who claims that diversifying their course ensemble or curriculum goes against their academic freedom in higher education? I can't speak to that as someone in academia, but, you know, standing outside of the machine, my response to that would be that that person needs to get out of the way. That person is a part of the problem. We've already identified that there is what we can do post-graduation based on what we're trained on is so limited. So if anyone is trying to push back against broadening that path, I see someone who just needs to be removed. But again, that's from my perspective as someone from outside of the machine of academia. Maybe other people have thoughts on that question.
Yeah, that's one of those easier said than done situations. You know, spending a significant portion of my life in that structure, I've seen what happens, and I see that that's the viewpoint that usually wins out, right? Because it's all part of the bigger power structure and the power dynamic and what guides all this. And so what does this mean? Well, I mean, infrastructure has to be dismantled. How do we go about doing that? I mean, these are the hard questions. It has to be done. We can figure out a way of chipping away at it. But when someone makes a statement like that, they're not getting out the way and no one's going to guide them out of the way. As a matter of fact, they'll stand behind and support that mindset. And as tragic and horrific as it is to admit that, that's the reality that I have seen, unfortunately.
The reality of academia being tragic and horrific. I appreciate your using those terms.
Yeah, so to a certain degree. It's a beautiful place. I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, to spend as much time as I have, there have been so many incredibly bright moments, and the students and the promises of hope and change, and those are all the things that just keep me pushing forward. And the being the eternal optimist, right? That has to be part of what we're about, our DNA, for those of us who are involved in this on the inside. But we also have to understand the realities of what we're up against and figure out strategies to move around that, or just to confront that, or, you know, deal with it in our own ways, and not just lie down and take it, you know, to a certain degree.
There's one more question here, and maybe Latanya, you have some thoughts on this, and then we can kind of wrap up. But this is from Rebecca Mangles. I'm a student at the conservatory in the Midwest who is mainly responsible for changing, Midwest. Who is responsible for changing educational curricula? Would it be largely professors, deans, provosts, other? How can students prepare to take reformative roles in education and further postgrad education? And partly I'm asking this because I know one of your students, Georgia, has been an incredible collaborator with Paula and I, and she's going to be leading a great conversation tomorrow. So yeah, I was just curious if you had any thoughts there.
Well, I think it definitely has to be a united front. You know, it has to come from all angles. It can't be something that is wholly led by the students. We have to have the cooperation of faculty. We have to have the cooperation of administration, and we have to have the cooperation of students in order to make these changes. We're asking to make big changes, and this is going to be really frightening to a lot of people. It's going to be frightening to a lot of faculty. It's going to be frightening to the administration, right? But we have to understand that it's not an either or proposition, right? We're not removing something and replacing it with something else. We're asking for equal representation at the table. And as long as we can begin to change that mindset, which is a very Western mindset, I must say, the either or proposition, right? If I'm right, you have to be wrong, right? Versus understanding that it can be an amalgamation of many things that actually makes for a richer table and a richer palate. But we have to come at it from that perspective and let them know that we're not trying to erase what we've had in the past. We're augmenting what we have. We're adding to it, and adding to the richness of the color palette, adding to the richness of the table.
And to just add one little point, I really want students to understand the power of their voices, yes, right? Because they will sit back and probably think, well, we'll let the faculty, we'll let the administration, we'll let whoever drive this, you know, drive the bus on this. But you guys, as students, you will be listened to, right? You have that united front. And if you are really well organized and you're promoting the change that we need, your voices will matter and you will be heard, right? It's a consumer mentality too, to a certain degree, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you are the you are the consumer, and you know your parents are part of that consumer profile. They're paying for your education. They will listen to you. I've seen a lot of change take place when the students unite and make things happen. Sometimes for the good, sometimes for not so good.
That's true. It's both sides of the coin. But, you know, I've been really gratified to see students at Oberlin stepping up and requesting some of these changes and doing it in a really smart, respectful, yet powerful way. And Anthony, you were spot on when you know, it is going to take cooperation from all fronts in order to really see these big systemic changes that we're asking for. But students, don't be afraid to let your voices be heard.
And what better way of showing this, of modeling this, than what the students have done with this conference, right? The students involved in ATMA and CMS, they're driving the bus, they're making this, they're making their voices heard, they're making the argument. So God bless all of you, you know, the students behind the scenes who are doing such incredible work. Don't stop. This is going to make a difference.
I would just say that I was on a panel a couple of weeks ago. We were talking about what we're preparing as higher education institutions. What are we preparing the students for? In the middle of the panel, I ducked off to go to a website called Musical Chairs. And it's a website that basically lists all of the available positions for particular instruments in classical orchestras in the United States and abroad. At that moment, there were exactly 9 jobs available on French horn in the United States, 9 chairs, 9 positions in orchestras, period. I have 18 French horn students in my studio alone, and this institution prepares them for either a job in an orchestra or a job as a teacher. So what are we doing? What are we teaching? What are we preparing them for? It's a borderline, and I said this, and someone said it's not borderline. I said it's a borderline Ponzi scheme. We're telling these students that once they graduate, they'll be available, these jobs will be available to them, and they'll be prepared to get them. Well, they're prepared, yeah, but prepared for what? Prepare for what? Got 9 jobs. 9 jobs. Thousands and thousands and thousands of French horn players. And that's just French horn alone. That's just French horn alone. So we got to be doing something better than preparing kids to play in an orchestra. And so the whole thing has to be rethought, reimagined.
Thank you all for your comments and participation here. I just, I also wanted to say if there's any students tuning in, you know, Paula and Georgia and I are seniors, and so we really need people to pass the baton to, you know. So Paula, maybe you could put my email or your email in the chat and reach out to us, and we're gonna continue these conversations. And this evening there's gonna be a Zoom conversation that I'll be there, and we're going to kind of have a follow-up on the conversation that we just have had and this afternoon, and think about how we can kind of operationalize some of these ideas. So please tune into that, and we're having another conversation at 3:30, and I'm going to pass it off to Ed, Sarah, to kind of bring it home here. And thank you all to the panelists, and thanks for everyone who showed up.
Thanks, Samuel. Thanks, everyone. Wow, this is, you know, it's funny. At 3:30, we have a session called Black Music Matters. And we just basically had that, you know, we really, when it started to go in that direction, this, not only this session, but actually the very first session of the symposium. So it's going to be, it's going to be real exciting, because I think we're going to be able to start that panel on an entirely new level. I mean, we're starting to really deal. And so I want to thank all the panelists. Now in the chat, I mentioned, so ATMA has a new initiative coming out called Radically Elevating Activist Leadership, we started, some of the questions that came up in this very session here are going to be the starting point. Some very difficult questions, people. It's going to be, this is not for the faint of heart. This is real, time to get real. We need to really, really up the game. And as I was saying, and thanks for being patient. I used my one, you know, I had my one allotment of barging in on somebody else's panel and I did it, but I couldn't contain myself. The, you know, there's a parallel to in the society. You know, we have, you know, like a newfound conversation on race supposedly happening in the last year. In progressives, and I'm talking as a white person to white people, we need to dig deep into our progressivism even. And that's some of the beautiful stuff and powerful stuff that's coming here. That hasn't happened, in my view, in music studies. We have a very homogeneous sort of progressive movement now that's really kicked in. Every school is issuing these incredible declarations. Oberlin has a very inspiring declaration. But now we're hearing some of the inner truths. Michigan, we have a very inspiring declaration. I won't go into the inner truths. And the intentions are really good. On a scale of 1 to 10, this is going to be the initial real question, radically elevating activist leadership. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate the kind of conversation that is happening? Anti-racism. And I always, by the way, I say racial justice, artistic justice. If we leave the artistic justice out, then we're confined to kind of a deficit thinking. That's a whole other thing. On a scale of 1 to 10, all right, me, I think we're in the negative numbers in terms of the, this is not a popular statement, but anyway, this is what Neil is, that Real is going to be about. But anyway, we're moving in that direction. Now I want to, I saw my good friend Sharon Grotto in the chat there, and I want to give a good personal shout out because Sharon hosted the first ATMA conference in the fall of 2019 at University of Dayton. Tanya was there. Anthony was there. Oh my gosh, a little bit of a small world here. And but that was a historic moment. And so this symposium is actually, you know, sort of the next stage of that. But thank you so much, Samuel, and your team of Georgia Hears and Paula Wilson for coming up with just a brilliantly run. I mean, the questions are so, and the way you guys are navigating the flow. You know, I'm just trying to think back about my time as an undergraduate. I can't not imagine myself directing traffic with deans and faculty members and the top ranked professionals. I mean, you guys are totally dealing. Brilliant. Okay, so I think, like I said, I think you know, we're just this is progressing like so wonderfully, and I strongly urge people to show up at 3:30 to continue with the Black Music Matters panel and exciting stuff. Thank you all. And also thanks so much again for College Music Society, Bill. Bill's definitely been toughing it out, just being there, you know, and, you know, Bill and I were both at the debriefing session at 5:00 yesterday, but Bill lasted longer than I did. But it's so wonderful. And I'm hoping that this is the first of many collaborations between ATMA and CMS.
I will just speak on behalf of CMS. I think we're both honored and challenged and simply delighted to be part of this. This is so much the right conversation, and it feels so much at our core to be doing what we can to facilitate it. So thanks for including us. And I can't wait for the next conversations. Sam.